My name is Elena Christina. Thank you for joining us today. I'm actually here with Audie Norr with Mars 2026. It is an amazing new nonprofit organization, a 501c3. Welcome.
Thank you. So let's try our juice. We need to pick something and taste. We have a nice tasting party.
Thank you. Which one is this?
Those are berries.
Berries.
Those are berries, which is very good, very healthy. It has a lot of antioxidants.
Cheers.
Cheers. Mm. Really tasty.
Yes.
Really tasty. Let's try. Let's try banana also. Mm, this one tasty. Berries are very healthy. And we're doing this juice party for a reason, because juice is very good for your health and well-being.
Right.
And why it's important? Because health, good health is important because we're going to Mars.
Of course.
We're going to Mars and it's only $20.
$20
to Mars.
Cheers to that.
To Mars.
Okay.
Very tasty. Please try something else. Oh, we have mango. Let's try mango also. Berries really taste good. Let's try mango.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. That's to Mars also. And let me start talking to you about the health a little bit.
Okay.
Very tasty. Mango is very tasty, but berries really, really good.
Yeah, I like the berry the best.
We have also blueberry. Let's try blueberry. It has a lot of antioxidants, so it's important for everyone's health. We'll try blueberry. To Mars again.
To Mars. Hmm.
Wonderful. So, let me explain what I mean.
Okay.
Health is important for one main reason, because we're going to Mars.
Right, of course.
So we have to have good health. Nothing else matters. Money doesn't matter, what college you went doesn't matter, how many colleges you finished doesn't matter. Health matters. But probably you noticed that I said good health, not great.
Okay.
For example, if you would want to become NASA astronaut, you would need to be in great health.
Okay.
Almost like Superman, because their technology and entire architecture and rocketry and the design of their systems put a lot of pressure on humans and the health itself. It's very taxing, very difficult for humans to use this technology. In my case, with my program and my architecture that I designed, it's very easy for human astronauts, for human crew. It will be a lot easier.
Wow.
So you don't need to have health like Superman or like Captain America, you know. Remember, you saw first movie, probably,
yeah,
right?
Definitely.
Captain America. when he was very skinny little guy before he went through transformation. So he couldn't even get into the army. So in my case, if you have just good health, you will be able to go to Mars.
Wow, that's amazing.
Because of the technological principles and designs I used to create entire system.
Okay.
It's different. I have different approach. It's different than NASA or SpaceX or anyone else is using. Because everybody on Earth, including NASA and other government space agencies like Chinese Space Agency or Russian Space Agency or India's and Japan and ESA in Europe, they're all using the same technology. Mm-hmm. Those berries are really good.
They are.
Continue. Get other juices, try.
Okay.
But those berries are really tasty. So, even Elon Musk and his SpaceX and Blue Origin and Orbital and Boeing and Lockheed and everybody else that is in private industry, private companies also use the same technology, the same technological principles.
Wow.
And designs. Mine are different. That's why my program is hundreds of times cheaper, and it's safe and secure for the crew, which is important. But still, health is important. That's why we're having this juice party and we're enjoying some juice today. In order to give you a little bit more information and idea why, for example, NASA has that particular technology, mm-hmm. and the way it was designed, we have to go a little bit into the history.
Right.
In the area of Second World War, when war ended right around 1950, mm-hmm. that's when we noticed that back then Soviets started developing their own space program.
Right.
At exactly 1950 almost. They started launching their rockets with dogs. They had almost 60 dogs in their space program, and they were training them, and they were launching rockets constantly since 1950. And the rocket technology and the way they were building it, I think it's coming from V2 rocket design that von Braun came up in Germany back then.
Okay.
And he ended up in the United States, and he was running some kind of rocket research group that was kind of absorbed when NASA was established.
Right.
I'll be talking a little bit more how NASA was created in a second. But Soviets were developing their own, but they were using the same rocketry, basically.
Okay.
Just like we're in the United States. And that's where the space race starts.
Right.
So-called space race, because Soviets and United States were competing. And Soviets were practicing with dogs. They were sending rockets everywhere in different orbit, close to the orbit, actually. They couldn't get to the orbit exactly yet, to different altitudes, and but they kept working on it. And in 1957, they launch Sputnik.
Okay.
And United States gets very worried. What is going on?
Right.
We are biggest, most powerful country with great technology, and they're sending Sputnik into the orbit. And then they launch famous dog, now Laika, into the orbit. Laika became very famous because it was the first dog that reached the orbit.
Oh, wow.
Around Earth. And of course they send more. The second successful launch into the orbit was with Belka and Strelka. So they were working, and of course after Sputnik, Gagarin in 61 went into the orbit. So United States started to get really worried what to do next because of 57 and Sputnik launch in October of 57. So our Congress started thinking what to do.
Right.
And Eisenhower in April of 58 sent a draft to the Congress to work on some kind of agency,
right,
or some kind of organization that would control and organize our space program. And that summer, I believe at the end of summer of 58, Congress passed legislation and established NASA.
Wow.
Originally in April, it was called agency with the director position that was head of the agency. But during the process in the Congress, someone decided to change to administration. NASA letters remain the same, but the last letter was saying not agency, but administration.
Oh, okay.
Space administration.
Right.
NAS, space administration, instead of space agency.
Right.
So now we had an administrator that was headed the organization instead of agency. And in 58, I believe October 1st, NASA official opened the door. So that's basically a little progression, a little bit of tidbits,
right.
How NASA was created, basically in response to what Soviets were doing.
Okay.
You know. And surprisingly, some people say electrical engineer, originally a guy by name Glennon, became first administrator.
Okay.
Instead of Dryden, because United States had another group called NACA. It was a committee.
Okay.
For aerospace. It's like advisory committee. And that organization was established somewhere in 1915.
Oh, okay.
So it was long, big organization that Dryden was headed.
Right.
He was the head of NACA. So everybody was thinking that Dryden will be elected administrator of NASA, because NASA kind of replaced NACA organization.
Hmm.
But the guy by name Glennon, originally just electrical engineer. He worked in some movie studios like Paramount and Samuel Goldwyn, I believe, studios or something like that. Um, Ah, those berries, really good.
Yeah, they are.
My goodness, I like it. And he became administrator. And what he did, and I hope with everyone joining our organization, with just $20 donation, mm-hmm. you become a member.
Right.
Basically, automatically. So if we, everybody, if we all together, we the people, join together, we will be able to do what Glennon did during very first days of NASA.
Right.
And this is what he did. He wasn't a rocket scientist. So he started acquiring and pulling in under NASA every possible research lab or organization he could grab it. Goddard, Ames Center, JPL, all kinds of ballistic missile commission, everything he could reach and grab, he was pulling under NASA.
Okay.
Research labs and the AIM Center, whatever. I mean, anything. Even some groups from DOD and military.
Okay.
He was taking over those. Of course, military didn't let go all those secret spy satellite and missile research things, you know. They kept it, but Glennon was grabbing everyone, and that's how NASA was building their rocket scientist and other scientists and everything.
Wow.
So they did, and I hope we can do the same. If everyone join our organization, we'll hire best rocket scientists.
Yeah, definitely.
And we'll be going to Mars right then.
So exciting.
Yeah. And that's pretty much the history. And just to finish the historical little tidbits, I want to mention JFK also.
Okay.
Because it's important, because he was an important person for the space program. When NASA was created in 1958, it was the first step. Good step. But in 1961, JFK had a space-related speech. Then in 1962, in Rice Stadium, he made, again, very important speech. And during that speech, we have very important sentence.
Okay.
And that sentence is very interesting because it has two halves or four quarters. That's how he laid out everything. First half, second half, and each has two little quarters. And for some reason, it looks to me like everybody, including NASA, remembers that first quarter when he said, we chose to go to the moon in this decade. And everybody remembers that. But then everybody forgot the second part.
Right.
And then they kind of remember third and fourth quarters. Not because easy, but because hard, you know, that ending, those two quarters about easy and hard. And everybody remembers first quarter. But the second part is very important because that's when you win games with the second quarter. It's very important little area. And it seems to me like everybody forgot about it. Because in 69, NASA landed the man on the moon. It was an incredible achievement. But in 72, they canceled the Apollo program. And everything was gone. music stopped. No more human space exploration. And that second quarter in JFK's very important sentence was, and do the other things which I interpret human space exploration, other things, you know. We can send all those satellites and little rovers and space probes as much as we like, but the main aspect of space exploration is human space exploration. And it seems like everybody forgot about it. And NASA cancels Apollo Program 72 and everything ends, and that's where we are. And in a sense, since those times, I was kind of hoping that they will restart human space exploration. Every year I would pay attention, you know, look and try to determine what NASA is doing. And nothing would happen. And that's why I sometimes say that's the sad part when I remember my own story.
Right.
It's a sad part because I was hoping that they restart space exploration, and I always hoped that NASA will be exactly what NASA is supposed to be, in my opinion.
Right.
Push the envelope. They don't need to do anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Just push the envelope as far as you can, because that's what they're supposed to do, in my opinion, you know.
Right.
And they're not. So, throughout all those decades, it was always part of me. I did a lot of invention, development and design, all kinds of different work before, since then, but Mars and space exploration was always in the back of my mind. I always had big excitement about it, but it was a sad time because no human space exploration. And even now, only NASA and SpaceX even talk about mission to Mars. No one else is talking about it. All other government-based organizations and private enterprises do not even talk about mission to Mars.
Wow.
Only Elon Musk and NASA is talking. So almost 15 years ago, I need to try my blueberries again. Very tasty. And almost 15 years ago, I actively started working on my own program.
Okay.
Because I believe we as the people mm-hmm. in this country have duty and responsibility to get together and help NASA to work and continue human space exploration any way we can, because they dropped the ball.
Right.
So we need to pick up the ball and run into the end zone.
Definitely.
We have to get together. That's why last year I created our 501c3 nonprofit.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really, really exciting time. And I'd kind of decided to try to contact everyone in the field.
Right.
Everyone who's involved in space exploration. From NASA to SpaceX to to foundations and nonprofits, planetary society, Mars Society, everyone else. Try to contact and share my enthusiasm that I finished the program and it's ready and I wanted to reveal all the secrets and inventions and innovations and everything. And I got nothing back. So I decided to create my own organization. And I would love to talk right now a little bit about who we are and what our goal is.
Definitely. I would love to hear that.
Great. Great. And probably you can notice if you go to our website mars2026.org, you will notice that I have on a homepage very clearly defined the mission statement.
Okay.
Go to Mars for $20 only.
Right.
That's our main objective.
Right.
Okay. It doesn't need to be millions of dollars. Just to give you an example, NASA is paying $80 million a pop to send an astronaut on Soyuz, to send an astronaut to ISS.
Hmm. And where's ISS?
It's in orbit.
Oh, okay.
It's spinning around Earth.
Okay.
For years and years now. And they're paying $80 million per astronaut, per single ticket.
Wow.
And to give you an idea why I have $20 donation, if we all together join together, okay, we can accomplish our own mission.
Mm-hmm.
And help NASA, because right now, even though NASA and Elon Musk only talk about mission to Mars, probably you notice in what kind of bad situation we are. Elon Musk doesn't have any human launch capability.
Okay.
He cannot launch astronauts. Yet. I hope he'll be able to sort it out, all the things that happened to his launches. We had a couple accidents. We lost some rockets, or he lost some rockets and everything.
Right.
But NASA also doesn't have any human launch capabilities. They have to put all their astronauts on the Soyuz rocket.
Right.
And this is the situation right now.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot launch any humans into space. That's why I have another important sentence for our organization. Either we all go or none of us is going, which is important because we have to band together.
Right.
And make it very easy, $20. It's a couple of big, large pizzas.
Yeah.
And a Coke or something.
Yeah.
You just skip one time and you're a member of our organization. And you'll be ready to go to Mars.
Wow.
And we have to help NASA to continue this mission. And only if we the people come together, we can do that.
Right.
Only if we do together. Okay. Now, someone might ask me, why $20?
Right.
$20 or more, but let's say $20. Why $20? I remember since last year in presidential election and what Bernie Sanders did. He raised a humongous amount of money with very tiny donations. So it means we can repeat the same.
Right.
The difference is here that during presidential elections, our votes don't count.
Right.
Pretty much everybody knew that he didn't have any chance. But in this situation, your vote counts. And I'll talk about how important it is in a second, very shortly. I'll give you all the details why this is so important, because your vote counts. Every single vote counts.
Right.
It's not presidential election. Your vote counts. But if I can go back a little bit, when I mentioned that I created the organization and I tried to contact and share my enthusiasm and all the information I had about my program to everyone. Mm-hmm. Now something crossed my mind, because I have a huge amount of information and only I know that information. So I thought I'll do a special offer. If I know for sure there are a lot of published authors and writers in this country, okay, and I know that a lot of them do not have best-selling book on their list, under their belt. I know they don't have it. I think I have so much information and data, and it is very specific and almost unique data that NASA even doesn't have it. Because of specifics in my technology and inventions and innovations and entire architecture, logistics, and everything else about my program, that we can maybe write a little book, and I'm sure that book might become best-selling book.
Wow.
Because I have a lot of information that no one else has. How to get to Mars.
Wow.
In very inexpensive, very safe and secure manner. That's why we're having this juice party.
Right.
Because health is important, but you don't need to be with Superman's health.
Right.
Or like Captain Rogers.
Right.
Speaking about Captain Rogers in his first movie, when he was very skinny and little guy, let me just give you an idea. In that movie, there is a very symbolic moment that it is important even in my situation, because it will give you an idea how I created my program.
Okay.
And how I came up with my technical solutions and inventions and innovations. Mm-hmm. That even NASA doesn't have. It's in that movie.
Okay.
If you remember, they were running in the morning, you know, they do their own running to exercise, and they get to that flagpole, and they're told that if someone will get the flag off the pole, they can ride in a jeep.
Right.
They don't need to run anymore.
Uh-huh.
So everybody jumps, tries to get the flag, and they can. Do you remember what Rogers did? How did he get the flag?
I think he knocked the pole down or something.
Yeah. He pulled the pin and knocked the pole down.
Yeah.
You don't need to do it the hard way.
Right.
You have to think what to do. You have to use different approach. You have to have different point of view. You have to analyze everything from any possible angle.
Right.
That's how I came up with my structure and my architecture.
Okay.
And my designs.
Interesting.
Those are the principles. I'll talk about a little bit in a second, shortly.
Okay, perfect.
But this is just an example. And speaking about health, it's important, but you don't need to be with Superman's health, because my technology will be able to take millions of regular people with regular health and go to Mars.
Wow, that's amazing.
Take everyone to Mars. Very inexpensively and very safely, because Just to give you an idea, I had a person as my main element first.
Okay.
The person. And then I started building my entire technology around it.
Okay.
That's why it's very inexpensive and very safe. To give you a couple examples and ideas about my train of thought, about the way I think, about how I approach every technological issue, for example. We know that we have many different theories how to terraform Mars. That's one example.
Mm-hmm.
People think how to make Mars habitable.
Right.
That we, people, humans can go there and live. We need to terraform it. By using the same principles that Captain Rogers used in the movie about the flag and about the pole, I designed and developed a system that is very, very inexpensive, very friendly to Mars itself.
Okay.
And it can start terraforming in a single digit years. Not in 100, 200 years.
Right.
But in single years, like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years, would make very major difference in terraforming Mars. Just to give an example about a couple other theories, I heard that somebody was offering to send a lot of hydrogen bombs to Mars and blow them up. So then for a million years, we cannot even get close to it because of radiation, you know.
Hmm.
Another theory that I heard, we need to build a lot of factories that pump CO2 into the atmosphere, create like global warming that
right.
we're experiencing on Earth. But that's again pretty much unrealistic because you cannot build anything there. In order to build anything, you need at least two or three main things like power, like electricity. You cannot do anything without electricity, or you need water. You cannot build anything without water.
Mm-hmm.
There is no water on Mars.
Right.
And another one important factor, in order to build something, you need roads.
Mm-hmm.
You need railway. You need highways that you can transport things. Nothing there. So how can you build everything? It will take hundreds of years to terraform Mars that way. And it will cost gazillions, basically. My system is very simple, very inexpensive, and it will start making difference within a few years.
Okay.
That's one example.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's because of that approach, you know, taking technology and looking at it from many different viewpoints, finding the best one.
Right.
To give you another one, we have a lot of debris flying around Earth in orbit. A lot of junk. Metal parts and little screws and broken pieces. And more it becomes dangerous. It creates danger to satellites and ISS and everyone who goes into the orbit. I have, again, designed, developed a very simple system that will clean it up very quickly, very easily, very inexpensive. If I can give you another example about if we go to auto industry and the way the cars are made, very good example. All the GMs and Fords and Chryslers and everybody else make cars the same way it was made 100 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing changed. Like Model T came off the assembly line back then. 100 years, more than 100 years ago. We're still building the same. Again, by using the same principles, the same secret sauce that I came up with. I'm developing and designing the car that is different, and you'll never get hurt in that car, let alone die, no matter what kind of accident you're in, you know. With my car, you can go straight into the concrete wall like 100 miles an hour, and you might have a bump or something. You'll just dust yourself off and you'll continue. And that's, again, the same approach.
Very interesting.
Like getting, like Rogers got his flag.
Right.
You just take different approach. And to give you last example, we go to pharmaceutical industry area. Mm-hmm. Or in pharmaceuticals and medications, supplements, and everything else. Because that's how I approach everything, pretty much. I guess I have very inquiring mind or something. You know, I think all those questions. And in this case, my question was, if we are all different, every single one of us, we have our own genetic makeup, unique genetic makeup, why we take the same medicine that has the same formula,
right,
like everybody else? We all take the same formula. Why we don't have medication that is specifically designed for my specific, unique genetic makeup?
Right.
Why not? Maybe there is, but I was looking all over the place. I didn't notice. I designed and developed the supplement that will be working on your health and well-being to improve it. And it's specifically designed for your genetic makeup. To make sure that you will get the most benefit from that supplement.
Interesting.
To improve your well-being.
Right.
And again, that's the approach that I take. So the same happened with my Mars mission program. Now, let me talk a little bit about what can we offer at this point as an organization, as a group, to everyone who joins us.
Okay.
If everyone comes together and they vote with your $20 or more or whatever. Basically, you can do actually more. Let me show you our IRS letter, which is important because when you create an organization, you are not automatically 501c3 nonprofit.
Right.
You have to do a little bit of work.
Right.
Your lawyer has to file the paperwork, then we have to submit to IRS. They do go through the approval process. You have to wait. I heard some organizations are waiting for 6 months or 1 year even just to get the approval. So it is a process, and we're so happy, and thanks to IRS, we got approval, and they send this kind of letter. In our case, it's January 18th.
Okay.
And for example, in the letter, IRS even describes that you are tax deductible nonprofit. And they even say that you can receive tax deductible bequests. You can receive devices. So hopefully people can donate cars, boats, planes, and TVs and everything else.
Wow.
I'm not an expert, but hopefully that what devices mean. Also transfers. I'm not sure what is that. And they also mention gifts under section 2055, 2106, and 2522.
Wow.
So this is important for everyone to know, for you to know, that when you join us, just by donating $20, mm-hmm. it's tax deductible.
Wow, that's good to know.
Or more.
Right.
Whatever. But why I'm mentioning this, it's important because if everyone joins us, we'll be able to offer different programs.
Okay. Like what?
So every member benefits. Hmm. Not only you go to Mars, which is automatically. By the way, one of the programs is a training program. When you join us by using your tax deductible contribution, you automatically become a member and you will qualify for training program. It means we go down the list. So it's important if you want to be higher on the list, you need to do it faster, sooner.
Okay.
We'll go down the list and we'll qualify people for the program, and we'll be offering different disciplines in the training program, because for inaugural flight to Mars, we have to have very rounded people that they know quite a few things, you know.
Right.
So you'll go through technical training and a little bit of medical training and a little bit of computer training, technology training, even psychological training, isolation, survival training, even a little bit agricultural and food production training.
Right.
Because you need to know all those little areas that will help you on the mission to Mars.
Right.
Because there are no help at this point, mm-hmm. you know. So people on the first mission have to be very self-sufficient.
Okay.
But that's only one of the programs that members will be able to take and run with it, basically. Right. That's one of the programs.
Okay.
Another program I call Mars Club Work Program, which is one of the more important programs that I would like to launch.
Okay.
More people will join, more people will get employment. That's my main goal. I would love to see everyone's joining our organization so we can start hiring everyone.
Right.
Why it's important? I would love to start entire industry. I call it Earth, Mars, exploration, and settlement industry.
Okay.
I would like to see a lot of people joining our organization so we can offer employment to everyone.
Okay.
We need to build everything. So more people will join, more people will get work. I believe it's important. In our current times, it's important. Because robots and automation is touching every industry almost nowadays. And that expansion is accelerating. It's not only manufacturing or heavy industries or car industry is losing all the jobs because of robots and automation. Now I'm hearing that industries that never were under that automation list, so to speak, gets invaded by automation.
Okay.
So more and more industries become automated.
Right. Right.
So we'll lose more and more jobs.
Yeah, definitely.
In this case, we are not, because space technology and rocketry and what we're to build and what we want to build requires human craftsmanship, requires very talented people working together.
Mm-hmm.
No automation. So I hope everyone will join us, and that's how we'll be able to find employment for a lot of people. I hope this industry will grow, because I know that at some point in future we'll have thousands of spaceships going to Mars and everywhere else. So we'll need a lot of people working in this industry.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody will have jobs. This is another program that I would like to launch. More people will come, more people will join us, more people will get together, more people will get employment.
Right.
Another program that I think very important would be activated and would launch if everyone joins us would be, I call it, revitalize your community program.
Okay.
Let me give you a couple ideas how I see this program working. If a lot of people join our organization, they become members, they can look around in their communities, even talk to mayors. It doesn't matter if it's big city, small city, little town, whatever it is, anywhere you live. You might even know mayor yourself, you know. Or you know city council people, you know. So you talk to them and see if there are manufacturing facilities or metalworks facilities or some kind of industrial facilities and buildings that are rusting away, abandoned. And you can say to a mayor, hey, look, this organization can come in, take the building, renovate, and start hiring people.
Right.
Because that's what we can do. If we, the people, get together and want to take care of our communities and stop erosion and abandonment in our communities, especially with facilities, industrial facilities and factories and everything. If you know mayors or city council members or anyone in the local government, talk to them, see if there is some kind of buildings that are abandoned. We can take a look, see if it fits our goals and our mission. We go and start hiring people. Which in turn will revitalize everyone around it, because you're not working in a vacuum. If you have nice facility up and running now and it's cooking,
right,
everybody around in the city or town or village would benefit, and they would get busy. And that's how you revitalize your entire cities and counties or communities or neighborhoods, you
right.
know.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope this program will work again, because we can do it. Again, if we come together.
Right.
We all come together. To give you another idea about another program, I would like to launch also a program that we call No One Left Hungry program. If someone is in a difficult situation,
mm-hmm.
low income situation,
mm-hmm.
If all the people join our organization, we'll be able to help those unfortunate. We'll be able to take care of their groceries and food. No one left hungry program. Make sense?
Yeah, definitely. That would be amazing.
We can do that. If we come together, we can do that.
Very interesting.
Let me give you another idea about another program. I call it Academy for Healthy Living. Health is important. So all the members, whoever joins us, will be able to take classes. And experts in medicine and nutrition and even Tai Chi or yoga, all kinds of different areas that would influence our health. You'll be able to take classes as a member. You'll be able to take classes and learn what to eat, how to take care of your health, which is important, I believe. And I have a lot more programs, a lot more ideas that might work if more and more people will join us.
Right.
Like health insurance program. Maybe we can get something working for all the members and you'll have your health insurance. Like universal health insurance, everybody's covered. Like retirement programs or pensions or something, you know, like 401k, but a lot more secure and better for everybody. Yeah. I have a lot of ideas, but I need everyone joining our organization. And as a member, you can even go to our website, go to contacts page, and send us a little email.
Okay.
Let us know. If you have even better idea, that would be great.
Yeah.
In subject line, just mention new program or something like that.
Right.
Very specifically, you know, new program, Mars Club program. And give me your ideas.
Okay.
So I'll be able to post those ideas on our website. And every member will be able to vote. Again, vote. Tell us which programs sound good and which one might not work, mm-hmm. but which ones are good.
Mm-hmm.
We'll implement, we'll launch those programs.
Wow.
So we have a lot of ideas.
That's amazing. Very interesting.
Thank you. Thank you. We need to take care of ourselves, because I know a lot of young people drowning in school debts,
mm-hmm.
a lot of problems, no work. We can do that. If we join together, we can do all those things.
Yeah, that would be amazing.
It will be if everyone's contribute. It's just tax deductible contribution.
Yeah,
you
not
can.
Much at all.
Not much, and it's tax deductible contribution. And when we join together, we'll be able to accomplish all the programs and go to Mars.
That would be outstanding.
That's our main goal. That's our biggest dream.
Mm-hmm.
To start the entire industry.
Right.
Which will grow and grow for next 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we'll have job security for next 100 years, because we have to build everything.
Right.
Make sense?
Definitely.
We have to build so that at some date, at some point in time, we'll have millions of people going to Mars.
Mm-hmm.
Because my program is scalable.
Okay.
I can take million people to Mars.
Wow.
We can build the settlement on Mars. And it is important for me to mention that if I go back to NASA and SpaceX, and Elon Musk talking about his mission to Mars, they only mentioning going to Mars.
Right.
They never said anything how to land on Mars, what we do on Mars, on surface of Mars, and how we take those astronauts back to Earth.
Okay.
They don't have even concept, I believe. Because they never mentioned how they are going to do that. I do, I know. I have entire program, step by step, how we go from Earth to Mars, we land on Mars, what we do on Mars, how we launch from Mars and come back to Earth and land on Earth successfully. I have every step down to the smallest detail.
Wow.
They do not have that. I do. I know it might sound funny, but I do.
Yeah, that's amazing.
They do not talk about it. What do you do if NASA launches and spends tens of billions of dollars just to launch the mission? They never mention what they are going to do when they get into Mars orbit.
Right.
And start going around the Mars. What's next?
Uh-huh.
I do not have any information. Maybe someone else, so please email me. Please go to mars2026.org and send me an email. I never saw what they have planned when they get to Mars.
Right.
Elon Musk just recently, I believe in December, a couple months ago, he had a presentation when he was talking about mission to Mars for more than an hour. And he never mentioned anything how he will come back, how his astronauts will come back to Earth.
Right.
I remember only three words. He said like three or four words that he'll refuel and go back. That means nothing to me.
Yeah.
I have everything down to the smallest detail, what we do. Okay. That is important. Their plans are just go to Mars. But Trump just now signed NASA budget, and it's only $19.5 billion. For NASA, it would take $19 billion or $20 billion just to launch the mission. That's how expensive that technology is. Right now, NASA is working on the SLS system and Orion capsule.
Okay.
That's supposed to be put together and they launch to space, moon or Mars or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But just to give you an idea how complex, how expensive, how complicated this mission would be, Orion capsule is 15 feet in diameter only.
Wow.
This is less than across this little room.
Yeah.
It's like the size of a minivan.
Right.
Because the mission to Mars is not just straight line from Earth to Mars and back.
Right.
Those are planets that are floating in the vacuum, with their own dynamics and their own gravity and their own orbits. They're moving, they're spinning. And only every 26 or 28 months we have rendezvous point. So it means we fly to Mars for 6, 7, 8 months, we cannot come back. We have to wait the next rendezvous point, which is 26 months later.
Yeah.
And then you can fly back. So the entire mission is 6, 7 months twice, plus 26, 27, 28 months to the next rendezvous point. At this point, Trump signing their budget and their plan for $19.5 billion, I don't think that money even will cover our mission to Mars. What about hundreds of projects that they are working now? They cannot abandon that. On SpaceX side, again, they're using the same principles, the same technologies like NASA, so it's very expensive again.
Right.
So it means Elon Musk has to raise a humongous amount of money just to make that mission happen.
Mm-hmm.
But he never mentioned how he comes back,
mm-hmm.
how the astronauts would come back to Earth, you know?
Right.
So this is the current situation. And SpaceX doesn't have human launch capability right now, and NASA doesn't have launch capability. So we have a difficult situation, but I have the program, I have the plan ready.
Oh, wow.
It's ready to go, so I just need everyone to join our organization and we'll start working on this program.
Wow, that's so exciting.
If we have a lot of people joining us, we'll be able to pool the money and hire the best scientists.
Right.
Best rocket scientists, mm-hmm. best technicians, best builders. And I will be able to share with all those people that we hire what we need to do,
right.
how the program works.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be able to push the envelope because no one else is doing that.
Exactly.
Right? I know that a lot of people are interested in mission to Mars, but you're not going. We are not going. NASA is not hiring anyone. I watched recently NASA channel, and regretfully I didn't see the beginning of that presentation where I saw someone from NASA administration was on a stage talking to audience.
Mm-hmm.
It was like conference or something, and he was explaining and talking about all the NASA achievements and great things that they did, and they're incredible, one of the most incredible organizations on Earth, I believe. But he mentioned also that they have more than 18,000 applications from people to become an astronaut. They are applying to become an astronaut.
Right.
NASA is not even launching anyone.
Right.
So you think they will hire anyone? Maybe a couple people. So all those 18,000 people, they'll never see anything.
Right.
They can contact us. We can build our program and we'll go.
Okay.
So this is the situation, because our main goal is to create an industry and grow it, work on it, build thousands of spaceships.
Okay.
So everyone can go to Mars anytime, basically.
That's amazing. Very exciting.
That's our future vision, so to speak.
Okay.
And basically, in conclusion, I just want to ask everyone, go to our website, mars2026.org, mm-hmm. and please send us an email, share your ideas,
right.
send us your concerns, ask questions.
Definitely.
I would be happy to answer everything, explain, and please check our website for all the new developments, new information, news, and everything.
Okay, perfect. Very informative. Thank you for that. And I look forward to learning more about Mars 2026 in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you
for having me.
And thank you for the juice. It was so good.
You're welcome. Juice is important for our health.
Right. Now we're a little healthier today.
Yes.
There you go. A step closer to Mars.